is certainly tough to come in behind such an anointing. But then it makes it easy for you to flow into the Spirit of God. I thank God this morning for such an early morning rise. Matter of fact, I thank Him sincerely for being awake. Praise the Lord. Amen. We had a good evening. If you just stand with me just for a second as we reach our hands toward heaven. Father God, we bless you. We thank you. We magnify you for who you are. We pray in the name of your Son, Jesus, that you will open our minds and hearts to receive what you have for us today, oh God. Heal somebody, deliver somebody, set somebody free. Make it so, oh Lord, that they can move the things and the problems out of their way, Lord God. Open the door to worship and to praise you forevermore. Father, we thank you today, Lord God, that we know that we can address our problems to you. As a matter of fact, God, we ought to stop telling you about our problems and tell our problems about you. Help us, oh God, to be mindful that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, and there's just nobody like you. Bless us, oh God, and keep us, Lord God. Hold us close to your bosom that we can feel the Spirit of the Lord penetrating and massaging our hearts. In the name of Jesus, we do pray and we thank you right now. Amen and amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We thank God again for our international presiding bishop, Bishop Harry R. Jackson, Jr., for such a man of God, and his wonderful wife, Pastor Michelle, and for the tiers of leadership, the council, and for you this morning. I have the assignment of working on the mounting of the family. And I will tell you that this came quickly, so it will go quickly. Amen. But actually, it really doesn't take everlasting to say things that are eternal. And we can go and work through an order of what's called pleonasm, meaning that you use a lot of words to say some simple things, and you can say it simple and get out of the way, and they can remember it better. Amen. So today, we plan to say things that would be for your hearing and not take a lot of your time. I thank God for my lovely wife, Brenda, that's been with me for 38 years. I have drug her, amen, all over the world, literally. Drug her all over the world. She gave up all of her career. She wanted to be a flight steward at one time, and she just ended up flying with me all around the world. So that's the best service she could give, amen. But I thank God for it. We have two wonderful sons and eight grandchildren, and we love them all, amen, and we're having a wonderful time with them. We just find out that we cannot handle them all at one time. We tried to unsuccessfully, amen, because we just about drove one another crazy trying to take care of our grandchildren. So we take two, three at a time now and try to break it up a little bit, but you know, my baby believes that she can take them on, and she takes them off down in Virginia and puts them all into an SUV. She makes me buy cars according to how many grand. I hope we don't have any more, because I have to drive a bus from now on. So we praise God for the gift of family. I want to just share with you for a few minutes how our marriage started, and then I'm going to let you know the intent of God, and then the move of God, and then the mountain of God, kind of in that order. First Lady Brenda and I were married in 1973 on May the 5th. She was born on October the 5th. I was born on November the 5th. People believe that we can't count past five because everything we do is on fire. Amen. But it's easy to remember. Though one season, one only, it only takes one. I forgot. It was only one. Amen. Out of 38 years, I forgot. I was traveling and going back, and I forgot about it. She said, oh, that's okay. And when she walked away, I said, uh-oh, that ain't okay. How many know you can't make up for a day that you miss? Amen. So just don't be like me. Don't miss any. Amen. Hold yourself. But we started off, and I come from a family of eight. Actually 10, one of my brothers and sisters passed away early on in my life, and then we were a big family. We were very cohesive. We stayed together. We did a lot of things together. My father was loved the Lord, and he thought that all of his children should play instruments. That's the way to keep them disciplined, to play instruments. So we all had to play instruments. And when you got pretty good at playing one instrument, he would move you to another one. So we were always at home practicing and staying together as a family, and he'd put us on television very young. We'd do some things. We'd play, and we'd be playing for the Lord. And, you know, my brothers, you know how it is. After a while, they heard the outside realm. Amen. They didn't want to play Great Is Thy Faithfulness anymore. They heard something else. Amen. So they start venturing out and start playing some jazz and rock and roll and all kind of things. But when we'd come together, we would be there for 5 minutes. Matter of fact, we just did it a couple of months ago. And we don't practice. I don't even know how we do. We don't practice. We just go together. So my older brother is an organist, and he was playing for George Benson for a number of years. And he just taps. He says, okay. He names the song. And he goes, pap, 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 bam. Just a few months ago. Them practice ain't been together in 20 years. And played it. Folks start coming around. And I said, man, that's a miracle. Boy, what if we could just do that for the Lord? Amen. But, you know, we threw in one or two. Had to, because I was there. Had to throw in a couple. But it just showed you the cohesiveness of the family. I say all of that to say this. When I married my wife, we went in Columbus, Ohio on May the 5th. Amen. And after the wedding, we went to our small place. I think our first home was a 14-by-70 trailer, not much bigger than this space. Amen. This looks a little larger than what we had. But we was happy. Very happy. And she began to cook things for me. And I said, babe, I said, you know, can you make a banana pudding? Sure, I'll make a banana pudding. So she made this banana pudding. And I say, you know, your mama's banana pudding is slamming. Every time I go, your mama's some, boy, she knows it's slamming. So I know she can cook banana pudding. So she finished cooking banana pudding. I could not wait. I went in, I put the spoon in and get ready to get some out. And I turned around to look for something. And I went back and I said, I know I put a spoon in that banana pudding. So I got another spoon. Then I dug up the spoon that I had because it was like soup. And I said, babe, I said, this banana pudding is a lot like your mama's. This is just soup. You know, you're going to have to learn how to, you know, ask your mama how to bake banana pudding. You know, I love banana pudding. She said, well, this was 1973. She says, I don't cook banana pudding like my mama. I'm not my mama. And if you want banana pudding for my mama, go over there where my mama is. I said, I ain't never seen that part of babe before. We just been courting all this time. I ain't never seen it. But today is October 28th, 2011. She has not attempted to make a banana pudding since that day. Now, I tried rubbing oil on her. Amen. I tried doing all these things for her, but it just didn't work. So, fellas, we have to be careful how we say things. It may not be what we say, just kind of how we say them. The Bible says a few things for us. I want to turn to Genesis 2 and 24. I quickly learned that there wasn't a textbook on marriage. Nobody showed us how to do it. We didn't know what to read up on to say how to be married, how to conduct ourselves, and what to do. At that time, there were no Dr. Fields and Dr. Spocks and all of that stuff that would give you some idea, though I wouldn't read those now if I were then, I don't think. But there was no textbook on how to be married and what to do and how to handle arguments and how to get past this and how to get past that. So I want just to revert back to what the Lord says and then see if we can make some sense of this mountain of marriage, this mountain of family. In Genesis 2:24, it says, therefore, and any time you see therefore in the Bible, you need to stop and look and see what is really therefore. It's a transition to something. So God says that he had made man and he had made woman, and then therefore man shall leave his mother and father and cleave to his wife. And God already knew that we were going to require this passage of scripture because Adam and Eve didn't have a mother. They were the first family. So he knew that that scripture was written for us that are to come. Amen. So he says, and leave his mother and father and then cleave to his wife. And they shall become so close to one another that they become one flesh. That they should become so close to one another that they become one flesh. That's why distant lovers don't work. Amen. So God's intent was for us to be right in each other's grill. I wish I had somebody. Amen. Not you in one bedroom and me in another. Not you upstairs and me downstairs. He says you are to become one flesh. In other words, we need to have it so close together with one another that people cannot tell us or see us apart. One thing about the church family that's kind of tragic is when you go to church for 20 or 30 years and you don't know who people belong to. They just get too busy doing church stuff. Amen. And there is not a day when you find out that Brother Johnson is married to Sister Johnson. They've been there 15, 20 years. Amen. But there ought to be a day. I know you have duty. But sometimes we have that duty to stay away from the dutiful responsibility that we have with one another. You know why I know that's a problem? Sometimes before we have church, I just look out the window of my office and peer and see how folks come in. You know, husbands and wives are rushing. Sometimes they come in. As soon as they get to the church gate, everything gets nice. But, you know, they forget that you saw them. And I know that wasn't a radio song. Amen. But when they get out and go to the door, everything seems to change. And then you watch the activity. Because they don't hold hands. He doesn't open the door. He goes to his post, she'll run over and get to hers, and both of them are just full of the devil, trying to serve the saints of God. Whew, my goodness. So God says we need to become one flesh, in mind, body, and spirit. Amen. So the bottom line of that scripture, it says, and they both were what? Naked. And they were not ashamed. Amen. So if we are married and we are one flesh, then there's nothing we can hide from God. And there shouldn't be nothing that I'm ashamed of that I can't share with that one that I'm one flesh with. Amen. Look, I know what it is because there were some old things that my wife's mother would put with her baby. Make sure you have your own little stash now. Just in case things don't go right. That's what they used to teach. Amen. And some of us still teach the same thing. Because your mother taught you that and your mother, her mother taught her that. But some things, you got to find where they come from. You got to peel back the onion and find out where it came from. Y'all remember the story about the ham in a pot and how the mother was asking the mother, say, well, you know, why do you cut the end of the bone off of the ham? She said, well, you know, baby, my mama did it, and you know, so I just cut it off the end of the ham. She said, well, I got to find out. You know, the young people, they don't take things at hand. They want to know why. So she said, well, I'm going to ask my mama's mama. So she asked the grandma, mama, why you cut the end off of the ham? Well, my mother used to do it. And, you know, cut the end off the ham. And so she kept going back, and finally she found the answer. And the answer after generations of cutting good ham off the end is the mama said, baby, I didn't do that for any reason. I just didn't have a big enough pot. And so we take on things sometimes to be the truth, and you don't peel back the onion to see if it has any validity to it. So putting your own stash to the side sometimes, amen, does not mean that you are gathering with one flesh. You are already starting to divide yourself one from another. Now, before I get really, I got to make you, you're going to make, you're probably going to get upset with me now. But this, you know, this hold on to yours and his. Some do it for a reason, I guess, but you know, I work hard. Lord, help me. Because folks say, well, I want you to marry me. I said, okay, you know, give me all your information. Well, my name is Parker Lance Johnson Smith Jameson Allen. I said, you got a spell. You taking your tree? What? Is that your family tree? No, that's how many times they have been united to one. And they're holding on to all of those grips. Amen. So the mindset has to be, let go of the grip. You know, marriages fail. I mean, ain't no doubt about that. Marriages fail. We would be foolish and naive to believe that your one name that you have right now will last forever. Though mine will. Amen. Till I die. But if it does not, let go of the grip. Y'all feel what I'm saying? So, God wants us to be one flesh, one mind, one body, so we don't have too many things attached to us. Let me read something for you about background. Traditional marriages, which means there is a mutual relationship of husband and wife. In an institution by which a man and a woman are joined together in a special kind of social legal dependence for the purpose of founding and maintaining a family. That's pleonasm to me. Because that's a lot of words to describe what marriage is. You could say, it's you and me. It's man and woman united for life. Really? So, you know, we take a lot. You know why it takes a lot of words to describe things for people? Because there's more room to work out something on your behalf that you want. When it's a long definition of things, it gives you more room to work out things and find holes in it. But it's when it's succinct and right to the point, then you don't have that room and you have to work within the bounds of what you read. That's why lawyers, how many lawyers we got to have? They get paid a lot of money for finding loopholes. You did it. You know you did it. But you hire a lawyer to find a loophole for you to say why you did what you did and you know you did it. Like income tax. Help me, Jesus. You know you didn't pay it. You know that you owe it, and you need to give it. Same thing with your credit card. Why hire a lawyer about something you did? Just do right. Pay the folk their money. Get it over with. Amen. We're getting too legalistic. After a while, you'll find a loophole for paying your tithes. Yeah, gross or net. That's all right. Let me work on the family mountain just for a second. The family mountain is clearly a mountain that is under attack. I want to highlight a few things for you, but it all relates back to the family. Just about every message to this conference has related back to the family. Bishop Searcy talked about the family. Er, Onan, and Shelah. Perez, he talked about it. I mean, we had it yesterday, talking about the family. And today we'll talk about it. But there's an attack on the family that's really unparalleled with all the other mountains. You see, I believe the mountain of family is the heartbeat of all the others. The family is the fuel of God's master plan. And Satan knows that the family, if I can just get to the family, if I can just divide the family somehow, I'll weaken the whole structure of the other mountains. You see, the economy mountain cannot stand by itself. Doesn't have any value if there's not a family. The religion mountain won't even have any value. Nobody to praise, nobody to worship if it's not a family. The government surely won't have a position if you don't have a family. So all of these mountains around, to me, seem to be paralleled or pointed toward the mountain of family. Now let's take some relevant issues. The abortion issue. It's an attack on the family. You can call it what you want, but it's an attack on the family. Maybe the economy has something to do with it because they think, I can't afford this child or we can't have this child together. But it points back to the mountain of the family. Education the same way. Why be educated if there's no families and there's nobody to talk to? Amen. So it points back to the family. Surely government, the mountain of government, if it doesn't have the family, it just won't, after a while, it just crumbles. There's nothing there. Nobody to go towards. So I believe these mountains come and circle around the family. Homosexuality, which scares most saints of God, but homosexuality is really an attack on the family. It's a plan of Satan to annihilate not only the body of Christ, but the whole world. Amen. How can you reproduce from something you can't produce? There is no read to it. Amen. So homosexuality is another attack of Satan against the family. If I can destroy those, in that, at least the part of the scripture that says be fruitful and multiply, I got a good grab. I got a good start. It won't happen. So what I have to do is mess up the mind of men and women to make them believe that they ought to be lovers of themselves. Even the fatherless spirit. In Malachi 4 and 6, Elijah says he will come to turn the hearts of the fathers back to their children. And the children's heart back to their fathers. It's a sad commentary. I'll tell you a short story. It's a sad commentary. I was ministering to 300 or 400 men that had other young men with them. And I asked this young man to come up, and he came up. And another one was with him. He wanted to come up too. I said, well, both of you come up, you know. And so they're about 11 and 12. And I said, well, my friend, I said, could you tell me this? I said, I'm just going to ask you a question. I'm going to just answer it honestly. Yes, sir. I said, what does a man look like? When they did what I just did, I knew I was in trouble. Because I thought he was going to say, my daddy. But they said, well, a football player? I said, wow. Okay, what do you think a man looks like? Well, sometimes they're tall. I said, these are men of God, a whole room full of men. And you can't point out. I said, hey, I'm pointing at myself.
What does a man look like? But our young people are not getting the image of what a father is because the father won't stay home. So they're looking on the outside trying to find out what a father looks like. And they go all around instead of going right to the body of Christ trying to find out what a father looked like. It was embarrassing to me. It was totally embarrassing to me, but they told the truth. So it says, I have got to get on my horse. I got to get on something to ride better and let somebody know that I'm a man, especially the young people. And the image of a man ought to be in the church because that's what God created. But these fatherless societies are crippling us, and it's another attack of Satan. Let's talk about the mothers. Mothers don't want to be mothers no more. After a while, brothers, it's going to be hard if you don't have a tailor. It's going to be hard for you to find a suit. Because the women are going to buy them all. I work with them. I'm not being facetious. I work with them. And I know a man's suit when I see a man's suit. And they walk in boldly like it's nothing. And you can be right there, and the other woman will call on the phone, and they'll talk just like it's nothing. So I said, man, what in the world? Jesus. So, you know, I start backing out because I didn't want the Lord to come. And me to be in the office with her. So I said, my God, we have got some work to do. The mind is being dropped off the scope and God is not being revered on any hand, and it's attack on the family. The mountain of the family is under severe attack. Follow up with a few things. The first family was placed in the garden. No mortgage. No foreclosure. No worries about the economy. Didn't have to worry about a teacher because they had the perfect one. They weren't worried about the media and the paparazzi trying to take pictures of them being nude in the garden. It wasn't there. Nothing about religion because I had the perfect teacher. All my praise went to the Lord. Everything was right. But then it doesn't take long. It doesn't take a long time for us to mess things up. Everything was right. Every day was the perfect day. Man, if Adam wanted to play golf, he didn't have to worry about rain. He didn't have to worry about washing clothes. None of that. Preparing meals, it was all there. Fresh flowers on the table every day. What do you like today, babe? Everything was wonderful. But it doesn't take long for us to mess things up. See, when First Lady and I first got married, everything was wonderful. Man, the honeymoon, everything, we didn't have a lot of money, but everything was wonderful. We thought we was having, we didn't have a real honeymoon. We thought we had a honeymoon. We just went out, we thought that was a honeymoon. We didn't go to the Caribbean. We ain't going no ship and sail and all of that stuff. We thought we was having a honeymoon. And we were happy about what we had. But then life showed up. Living showed up. What's that? Well, you know, baby, this, okay. Now, you know, I had sisters and stuff. But you still don't get the intimate things until you come together. I'm just being real with you. So, you know, she has some things over there that I didn't understand. Some things over there, you know, so. Okay, all right. You know. Well, baby, just leave that alone. Okay. So the first couple of nights, she'd go. Click. What'd you cut the lights off for? We married now. Oh, baby, shoot. You know, I got to get used to this. I ain't used to walking out in front of no man with no clothes on. Yeah, but I'm, you know, I ain't understanding all that. It took a little while. She was a bachelor girl for a long time. Real long time. My honeymoon started real late. But look, it don't take long for us to foul things up. It doesn't take long for us to start breaking covenants that we just agreed to. Amen. I'm a lover through thick and thin, in sickness and in health. All of that. We're going to obey one. We're going to love. Oh, everything is great. But then after you leave that podium, wherever you are, with that preacher or judge, whoever you're with, and you leave and go your way, the covenant starts to crack. Things start to go south on you. Same thing with Adam and Eve. Things start to break up. I can't understand open marriages. Open marriages. I can open the door. Amen. I even have an open mind about things. But open marriages is something that drives this brother crazy to even think. Amen. But some people believe that their covenant has been broken with one another, and open marriages is all right. I'm talking about saints. I ain't talking about those in... I'm talking about the saints of God with open marriages. And they know it comes, well, if we stay together, that's all that matters. That's what God wants. No, God wants you to get right. Amen. The open relationships will wear you down. That's where you don't care. Let me just make it plain. That's where you don't care. You go out and you sleep with who you want to sleep with. And the husband goes out and he sleep with who he wants. Then y'all come back together. And every now and then, y'all sleep together. That's open relationship and open marriage. Amen. That's what I thought. Amen. That's what I feel. And then they have another marriage. See, marriage is defined all kind of ways. Then they have this thing called a shotgun marriage, where someone is forced to marry someone because they're pregnant. Short story. My son came home one afternoon. I had just bought a brand new Volvo overseas, Bishop. And they wanted to go to the prom, him and his date. And I said, okay, man, you can go to the prom. I had a little Mazda 626, and then I had this brand new Volvo, barely had dust on it. So he started walking around in circles. I knew what he wanted. Hey, Dad. What would you say if I went to the prom? Ain't going to be no whole lot of guys now, because I know you don't like no, just going to be me and Chris. I said, I think I'd be fine. Aren't y'all going to take some girls? Yes, sir. I said, okay. Come on, Dad. You know what I'm trying to say. No, I know what you're trying to say, son. Can I take the car? Sure. No, I mean the Volvo. Sure. You can take it. There. The new Volvo. Says, sure. So he comes, him and his dates, they come up. We lived on the fourth floor in the housing area. They come, the little girls come. They're sitting there, you know, and they want to take pictures. You know, that used to be the thing. You know, they don't even do that. No, they don't even come in the house anymore. Amen. They just go out there or meet them somewhere. But they come in the house and they're sitting there. So I said, how you doing? Fine. I said, y'all looking wonderful. Y'all looking very pretty tonight. I hope y'all have a nice time. Dad said, well, Dad, we're going to be in, you know, pretty late. I said, okay. So I said, let me ask you a question before you go. What's that, Mr. Palmer? I said, are y'all sexually active? Daddy! ready. What? I said, I just want to put something on your mind before you go. Because I know what proms do. Proms make you go crazy. Proms make you do things at the end of the year to celebrate something that you'll be sorry for the rest of your life. That's what proms do. Now, I'll repeat the question. Y'all plan on having sex? Daddy, that Lord Jesus, daddy, daddy. I ain't heard him call on Jesus in a while. It kind of made me feel good. So he sits there. So they leave. They're going out. So y'all have a nice time now. Yes, sir. About 10 o'clock, he comes back. Oh, daddy, shoot. We don't need the car. We just take the Mazda. We just going to go over here to the little pizza pub, whatever it is, on Ramstein, and then we'll come back. He's like, I said, what's the matter, son? Dad, you know, man, come on, Dad. You just broke my whole stuff down. Amen. But the thing that I want to put in his mind is to avoid the shotgun marriage. You see, because that night, had I not said what I said, would have been the night that he'd treat somebody's daughter like I didn't want him to treat it if it was my daughter. So I trained my son, look, you treat this girl as if it's my girl. Amen. And if you can treat her and love her like it's your sister, before you accept her as your wife, you're going to have a good relationship. Yes, sir. But if you go out and you treat her like somebody else, it's going to be just a one night gone, see you later. And you'll be sorry for the rest of life. He stuck with my plan for about 15, 20 years. Then he lost it. He lost the plan. Then he went off with somebody and it caught him. Had a child out of wedlock. And it was like sleeping with the enemy. I said, see that kind of woman right there, boy, that you went and laid with? She'll cut your ties. She'll rip up your seats. You come home, you won't have no clothes. She'll tear them up. She'll throw them out the apartment. You done got you a crazy one right now. And all for a few minutes of joy. And right now, he's still moaning. Because my grandson ain't but 12. He got a long time. I'm just being real honest with you. And then, let me hurry on. We have the common law marriage. Lord, have mercy, Jesus. A marriage where the parties come together with themselves and cohabitate and then come off later on after they've done it for a little while and say, we married. Common. When they come to me and say they married common, I say, yeah, that's what you are. That's how he's treating you. Like you're common. If he had the right intent, he would have taken the right steps. I said, why don't we just go ahead and do it now? Well, what's a piece of paper mean? See what I'm saying? And I look right at her. Don't bother me. You're common. He's treating you common. He doesn't want a relationship with you at all. Amen. And the fellas get mad. They get upset because you're messing up their game. Amen. But we should be there to mess up their game. Oh, my God. I wish I had somebody. So I try to work on it very hard when my wife and I, we started a marriage. We started a marriage care session. It wasn't even marriage relationship when we started. We just had two couples in our home that was coming. They was having some issues, and they thought we were doing good, and we'd been married every bit of 6 years by that time, and they thought we was doing real good. Amen. And you know, I said, maybe what they're coming, you know, they just think we're doing okay. I said, you know, we done had two-thirds of our marriage been good out of 6 years. So, you know, we get 4 good years, and two years was, you know. But they think it's been nice, you know. Amen. So they start coming. And then the next week, some more came. And we were praying with them and talking to them and just telling them the truth about our relationship and some of our flaws and things, you know, just common things that they would know. And after that, 6 came. And my wife would go in there. She would always cook up wings and have all the stuff, wouldn't you? But she had everything laid out. And, you know, we'd sit and snack. We'd talk about relationships. And they seemed to be getting better. And we said, oh, baby, this is good. This is really good. The Lord may be leading us in this direction to help couples stay together. You know, so we got serious about it. Didn't have no internet then. Didn't have nothing you could press then. So we read, and we were overseas. So the library wasn't full of a whole lot of information that you could get. But we start learning about the relationship, which was helping ours. We really didn't know what was going on. See, we went out to help them when the Lord was helping us. So we kept getting all of this data. And the more we got, the more came. Until it come to the point where the stairwell was full. We couldn't get them in anymore. It was just so many that were coming, and we moved it over to the chapel, didn't we, Bishop? We moved it over to the chapel. And we would start ministering there to them, and after a while we'd have women on one side and men on another side, and then we'd bring them together after we'd talk to them about the roles of relationship. Mm-hmm. Amen. So I believe that God had that ordained plan all along, not for them, but was really for us. And here we are, 38 years later. Let me hit a few more things, a couple of minutes. Same-sex marriage, it is what it is. I don't even have to talk about it. It is what it is. It's a foolish thing, and God does not like it. Oh, why don't you leave them alone? Why can't we all just get along? God loves them too. Amen. That's true. God does love them, but the spirit that they carry, he doesn't. You understand? God wipes out bad spirits. Do y'all remember Balaam when he was on the road with this donkey? And the donkey could see the angel of the Lord on the road. And that the donkey veered off the road because he saw the angel of the Lord on the road with a sword in that hand. Y'all remember that, don't you? And as he moved, the Bible called him an ass. As the ass moved off the road, see, somebody don't even, y'all just be careful. But that's what it called him. He called him the ass. So he moved his off the road. And then Balaam would beat him. Said, get back on the road. So he'd get back on the road. Said, man, you can't see what I see. And so when the ass got back on the road, he decided to try to help his master out. And he went over to beside the wall and crushed his foot. And Balaam beat him again, and the ass ran back off the road again. And the third time he came back on the road, and the Lord said, is wrong with him. He wasn't talking about the ass. He talking about the one riding the ass. So he had to reveal himself unto him so he could see the angel on the road. And then he got to the point where he says, look, I'm going to have to open up the mouth of the donkey so the donkey can talk to the man. Now you know, and I know, had you been riding that ass and it start talking to you, it would have been a separation of church and ass. But watch this. It must have been something common. Because it didn't bug Balaam. He had conversation back with the ass. And he said, why you beat me like that? He said, man, you better be glad I didn't have a sword in my hand. Because I told you to go on the road and you didn't. If I had a sword on my hand, I would have killed you. Then the angel of the Lord shows up. Balaam finally sees what he can't see. The Lord says, you know what, Balaam? You better be glad for that ass. Had you come a little closer, I would have killed you. I would have taken you out because you had the wrong spirit. I say all that to say this. God doesn't mind the person. He loves the person because the person's on a mission to do things for the Lord. But the spirit, he will wipe out. So the spirit of homosexuality, you talking about it's all right, just leave them alone? No, 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 no. They got a bad spirit. And God is going to kill that spirit. If they choose to let the spirit remain in them, then they're going to be wiped out too. Amen. There's too many cases where the cause of our emotional well-being is caused by the dysfunctional family. Everybody's got one. Everybody's got somebody. Everybody got a crackhead in your family somewhere. Everybody got a drunk in your family somewhere. Everybody got a child molester or you know, somebody got in your family somewhere. Everybody's got somebody that's not doing what God is telling them to do in your family somewhere. And that family member is causing you the worst time. Now, you can ignore it, say, I don't want to be around them. You can be ashamed of them, whatever the case may be. But they're in your family. And it is an attack of the enemy on your family. This mountain that we're talking about, the family, is an important mountain that God wants to surround his angel, you around, to protect this mountain. I know the economy is important. But the fact of the matter is, some people don't even understand that we were in a recession. Because you're still driving. The moment the big SUVs went down because the gas prices went up, you went and bought a big SUV. You wasn't worried about the gas. Still a recession. So the mindset is there. The mindset is that the economy is not it. Education is not it. You got student loans that you still probably have to pay off. Amen. If you went to school and went beyond high school and got student loans. So education, it's the family. The media, you're not afraid of the media, are you? No, because we got cameras and everything. Cameras on all time of day and night. You're not afraid of the media. Excuse me. Media doesn't drive you away. It's the family. Religion doesn't even drive you away. It's the family. Amen. Let me go back to the scripture real quick. Then I'm closing. This is coming from 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 4. You don't have to go there. I'm going to read it for you quickly. The Lord says, but know this, that in the last days, perilous times or grievous times shall come. For men, the family, shall be lovers of self. For men shall be lovers of money. They'll be boastful, haughty, rebellious, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, and without natural affection. There we go. That's in the end. That's how we know that we're in the last times, because we're sinning right before our very eyes. Truth breakers, false accusers, and no lovers of anything good. You know anybody like that? Sure you do. That's why we know we're in the last time. This mountain. It's the mountain that we have to work on severely. I know the economy is important. I know that I'm not discarding any of those, but the mountain of family is the mountain that will destroy all others. And Satan knows it, and I hope you know it now. Amen. Give God a hand praise.